All right, good evening, everybody. Welcome to Wednesday night here at Abundant Grace Church. Glad you guys are here in person and also you guys joining us via live stream. So are we ready and are we prepared? Use that word every week for a reason, right? Are we prepared to worship the Lord? Have we come with that pure heart of praise that the Word of God talks about? And it's that simple, right? It's a pure heart of praise. Do we praise God for, you know, based on how our day went, based on if we faced some challenges, based on if everything went perfectly, or do we praise God purely out of a heart knowing how good he is to us, right? And that is not predicated upon the circumstances we face. It's predicated on the fact that the circumstances we face have been overcome already by Jesus. Amen. So let's stand on our feet. Let's prepare our hearts again for worship. Let's magnify the King. Father, we thank you for this opportunity to be here this evening. We come to you wide open, Father, a wide open book, asking you to write on our hearts tonight, Father. Anything that you want to give us, we receive tonight by faith, Father. As we come and join our faith together to hear from you, we know we will. And we thank you, Father. We thank you for imparting truth to our life this evening. Speak to our hearts through praise and worship, Father, as we lift you up and honor you, because you are worthy to be praised. We glorify you. We thank you for the manifested presence of you in this place this evening. We say, Holy Spirit, take over. This is your service. And we thank you for it all. And we say, bring glory to yourself this evening. In Jesus' name. Amen and amen.
Hosanna, Hosanna. Oh,
God, God is good, right? You guys may be seated. All right. I feel like we had church. We did. Thank you, Sammy. It's great to worship the Lord, right? Something about just putting it out there, right? Magnifying him and his goodness. Amen. So we just did that, and we're going to continue to worship the Lord by receiving our tithes and offerings. So if you guys need an envelope, raise up your hands. And Paul will make sure he gets an envelope for you. So, how many people know that God made us a promise? He said, trust me. Trust me. Now, I'm generalizing God's promises, but God's promises, you know, we're told we receive God's promises how? By faith. And faith is what? A trust, right? And that is also spills over to where our giving lives are concerned. You know, if you go over to Malachi chapter 3, it's the only scripture that I can find in the Word of God where God says, test me. Try out my trust. Right? You may have heard this expression. It's actually a line from a movie. But it's a line that resonated with me. And I forget the movie. But it's about a relationship. It's actually that movie with Sean Connery, and I can't think of her name. And they steal paintings, right? Entrapment. And they're trying to figure out if they can work together, you know, because she was actually part of the insurance company, but she really wasn't. She was the thief as well. And they were trying to figure out if they could work their partnership. And he goes, first we try, then we trust. But God says, we don't try, we trust. But I'm telling you in this one verse of scripture, try me out. That I wouldn't pour out blessings on you that there isn't room enough to contain. You think God is faithful to watch over his word and perform it? And is our giving lives, is that addressed in the word of God? It is, right? Sowing and reaping is a principle and a covenant promise that God established in this earth. And the Bible in Genesis tells us, as long as the earth remains, seed time and harvest time. And the good news is, as believers, when we sow in our seed into the good ground of advancing the kingdom of God, right, advancing the gospel, God says, you know what? I'm going to pour out blessings, but I'm going to take that seed you've sown, and I'm going to multiply it back to you. We serve a God of multiplication. How many people of faith that we look at in the Bible, how many times has maybe this happened in your own lives? And I hope it has, because it's happened in mine, where I've sown something in faith, whether it's time, finances, whether it's a possession, whatever. Everything reaps after its own kind, right? You don't sow an apple seed and get a tomato plant. It doesn't work that way. But how many times God's multiplied back to us what we've sown? No, I want my children to have more because they trust me. Amen. Glory to God. And when we sow into the kingdom out of a heart that's right towards the things of God, Man, that's just an amazing set of principles that God's put to work here, even in this cursed earth, right? Didn't matter. Doesn't matter what the enemy says. Oh, it doesn't look good. You can't sell. Yeah, I was reading a devotion this morning. I forget who it was. I think it was Brother Copeland, actually. It might have been even Brother Jerry Seville, talking about how the enemy wants to come and talk us out of sowing when we have financial lack in our lives. Oh, I can't afford to sow. Can't afford not to. Right? This isn't about finances here at the church. This is about a spiritual principle that God's established here in this earth. Right? The way we operate. We are, that glory to God, we are not part of God's, of the world's economy. Because the world's economy is subject to market fluctuations. I can't put it any other way. And for those of us that follow the market, you know, in my business life, I'm forced to follow the bond market, the treasury market, what the Dow's doing, what the Nikkei's doing, what the dollar's doing, right? And we could see that if you have an IRA, a 401k, right? That's the world's economy. God says my economy trumps that economy. Therefore, if it doesn't look good, it's only temporal. Sow your way out of the don't look good. Because God said, looks good to me. Yeah. Amen. I said that all to say, because I know our heart here, the pastoral staff heart here, is wanting to see every single one of you blessed. Right? And the only way to truly be blessed is to do it God's way. Is it always fun? Nope. Does it always make sense in the natural? Doesn't have to. I always think of Abraham, because we've been studying Abraham a little bit on Friday in Faith and Healing School with my time here for Faith and Healing School. And I always think of that little tidbit that God gave Abraham. Go to a land I will show you. Hang on a second. It's pretty good here. No, no. Get out. Get out of the land. Get away from your family. Go to a land I'll show you. Lord, can you show me the land in advance so I can think about it? Think about that. Think about that where giving is kind of concerned. You know what? Sow the bigger bill. No, Lord, that can't be you. That must be the devil. Right? He's trying to talk me out of my finances. Nope. There's a step of faith involved. Amen? Glory to God. You can receive the offering. I'll pray. Father, we thank you. A little extra. We thank you, Father, for the opportunity and privilege to sow into your kingdom, Father. We thank you that your principles here are sowing and reaping, Father, and we believe in our heart of hearts that all your promises work, Father. And as we've sown the good ground here at AGC, and that the money goes to advance your kingdom, Father, it will produce for us a 30, 60, 100-fold return, Father. And we thank you that you're the God of multiplication. We thank you for more and more harvest coming our way so we can turn around and take that multiplied seed and meet other people's needs, meet needs of ministries and churches, and be a financial blessing to those who have lack. But most of all, that you'd be shown clear as day through it. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Glory to God. God is good. All right, so we're on actually week 10 of the book of Ephesians. We're rolling now. We're rolling. As long as it doesn't take us another 10 weeks to wrap up the book of Ephesians. But the more and more I read chapter 6, so I'm ahead of you guys in my study time. And it's power-packed with what we need as far as truth goes to live here on earth in these last of the last days. So if you have your Bibles, turn over to Ephesians chapter 4. I asked Sammy to do two songs because she was by herself tonight, but I also wanted to try to get into some more meat here so we could make a little bit of progress. So Ephesians chapter 4, right around verse 7 is where we left off last week. And let's just pray for wisdom, okay? Father, we thank you this evening, for wisdom and guidance in your word, Father. And as we've come expecting to hear from you, you will never disappoint us. Open the eyes of our understanding and lighten us to the truth of your word. We're thanking you for impartations of that truth tonight into our hearts so that we can take what we receive and apply it to our lives. and that we would facilitate the kind of change that you'd want for us. And we thank you for it all. In Jesus' name, amen. So we left off, like I said, somewhere around Ephesians chapter 4 last week, somewhere around verse 7. And I want to start reading there. But to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, he says, when he ascended on high, he led the captivity captive. And this is what we looked at last week. Did we have an adversary that sole purpose was wanting us to be captive to him? Satan wanted us to remain captive to his deceit and his lies, right? What's his sole purpose? To steal, kill, and destroy. We should know that well, right? To steal, kill, and destroy. You guys have heard me say this before, but a light bulb went on a couple years ago when I was sitting at a men's conference in Rhema in Tulsa, and Pastor Craig Hagen actually said this. I always thought it was interesting, the phraseology in the thief cometh not except to steal, kill, and destroy. Like, he wants to steal from you. I get that. He wants to steal the good journey, good life that God's promised. And then he wants to kill you. But how could he destroy you if you're already dead, right? And you sit there and you go, that doesn't really make sense because I'm killed, I'm kind of destroyed. So if I'm dead, what's left to destroy? He wants to destroy your legacy, meaning the generations that would have went on beyond you had he not been capable of killing you. So he wants to destroy everything that goes down the line after you. He wants to wipe out your legacy. And that's his sole purpose. And it was. And how does he do that? By keeping us captive to his deceptions and his lies. But yet Jesus, when he ascended, he led captivity captive. And gifts to men, verse 9. Now this is, he ascended. What does it mean? But that he also first descended. So the ascension came after descending somewhere. Where did he go? He went literally to the pit of hell and said, you wanted to keep my people captive? I got another plan. And my plan is to make a fool out of you, your cohorts, and your devices. And I'm going to sit here. We're going to do battle. You lose. We win. And so do my children. Amen. Now, that's the bridge. I guess that would be the abridged version, not the unabridged version. But that's what Jesus did. The fight on the cross, people like, you know, oh, he went to the tomb and he was dead and buried. And on the third day he rose. Well, there was a lot going on from the death on the cross to the resurrection because there was a battle being fought in between for you. So that what? We didn't have to fight the battle. Amen. Now, why is Paul saying this to the church at Ephesus? Remember, they're in a spiritually charged demonic atmosphere in the middle of a town that did nothing but worship the occult. And it was, and I find it fascinating, Timothy being the pastor of the church at Ephesus, and he went through a lot. 1 Timothy and 2 Timothy, when I'm encouraged and discouraged in ministry, are my favorite books to read, because that's what Timothy went through. Overwhelmed by this prospering church at the beginning, feeling unqualified to minister and be their pastor, and then everybody deserts him in 2 Timothy, right? And here we have the biggest church at the time being grown in Ephesus in an atmosphere that was the devil's playground. They needed to know this. Because what they were about to face, they needed to know that Christ already fought and won the battle on their behalf. He took the captor, the person who wanted to keep you captive, dead in sin, no blessings, walking his ways, chasing after him, right? And keep you there. So that what? He could steal your life and your legacy. That simple. And for me, had I stayed there, I'd be dead. There's no doubt in my mind when I sit back and I meditate not to look back, just to really look back at the glory of God in my life and what he's done for me, I should be dead. You should be dead. And I'm not kidding. You know, she's written a book, which only touched on the fringe of it. I know many of you read her book. Only touched on the fringe of how many times God saved her from a, you know, her life story and what she used to do for a living, and literally the doorstep of death, to where she was around people that had made, that were literally featured on Dateline, killing somebody else that was in their house for a period of time, staying with them. She had stayed with them once before. Truth? Truth. Those types of things. Me, the same way. Why? Because Jesus went to the heart of the earth. We as believers recognize that and say, he did something. He did something between the death on the cross and the resurrection that made me not have to deal with this enemy that wants to keep me captive. He's been dealt with. He's been not only dealt with, he's been defeated. And there isn't thing one he can do to you unless we let him. Amen? Colossians chapter 2, verse 15 says this, having disarmed, that's a powerful word. When you disarm somebody, think of it as a soldier. Think of it as a, you know, police officer disarming a perpetrator. What does it mean? Their weapons have been stripped from them. Now, we think the devil has weapons because we even call them weapons. But the weapons he tries to use are nothing more than fake. Lies. Because why? He's been disarmed. When he comes to you and say, that sickness is going to take you out or under, he's lying. That poverty, you know, your family was poor, you're always going to be poor. That's a poverty mentality, and that's what? A disarmed lie. Even in the natural world, when I coach in business, I'll have salespeople that I coach that don't think they can be successful. They're trying to go it in sales, but don't think they can be successful because they grew up in a poverty mentality. Meaning, well, we've always had just enough to get by. If that's your mentality, guess what? You'll always have just enough to get by. Right? It's a mindset. But we not only should have a spiritual mindset that's in tune with what the Word of God says is ours, we should know that the enemy's been defeated and been disarmed. He's been stripped. Disarmed principalities and powers. He made what? A public spectacle of them, triumphing over them. You know, when Jesus went to the cross, the Word of God tells us he endured the shame. It was done publicly. It wasn't done in private, right? It was, and I still to this day, it always reminds me of the triumphant entry. Jesus comes in, and the people are screaming, Hosanna in the highest, and they're laying the palms down, and they're worshiping Jesus, and the same crowd, days later, is screaming, crucify him. Both of those things were done in public. Our scripture in Colossians 2 says, he made, meaning Jesus, made a public spectacle out of them. You did this to me publicly, I'm doing it to you publicly. So everybody's going to know that thing you tried to do to me, where you thought you succeeded, you actually failed and completed my Father's plan. Which is to what? Bring you to naught. Zero, not one thing you can do about it. Or against my people. That's good news. That's really, really good news. So let's move on. Let's get somewhere. Let's get where the Holy Spirit wants us to go. And I don't know where that is. We're going to find out shortly. I'll let you know when we're done. Over in Ephesians chapter 4, we're in verse 11. And he himself, meaning God and Jesus, gave some to be, and this is, we start to talk a little bit about ministry, apostles, prophets, evangelists,
and some pastors and teachers. We know this, right? We know that there's apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. What do we call them? Fivefold ministry gifts, right? But the reality is many people operate in an overlapping office when we talk about the fivefold ministry. I'm going to look at this a little bit differently tonight. Not differently, it's the word of God, but what God really put on my heart to be aware of in these last of the last days. Would we agree we're living in the last of the last days? Amen. Time short. We talked about last week, without going back and looking at it, the importance of being in unity as a church, meaning the church of the blood-bought church of the Lord Jesus Christ, the whole church, every band of believers everywhere, to get into unity and start really focusing on what we agree and stop arguing and quibbling over the little doctrine that we don't agree with. You know, and we can know how trivial it can get, right? So we need to be in unity, but in the last of the last days, we know that God himself has ordained some to be apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers. For what? The equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. And it goes on to say, till we come to the unity, which really means to get into agreement. But here's what we need to be careful of. I'm not, and I've said this numerous times, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with what I'm about to say, but we need to be careful. We need to know this before we turn on the television and do this. What do I mean by that? I don't watch Christian television. You guys have heard me say that. If I'm scrolling through, which is rarely because where the channels are, they're not as close to the sports channels as, you know, like TBN and Daystar and all those. So I don't really scroll by them. But if I happen to scroll and I see something like, hey, Rhema Praise, I know them. I'll put that on, right? Or if I happen, I know Rick Renner's on and Jerry Seville's on and, you know, a couple people here and there, I would stop by. But if we don't know, and we just don't know the word, and then we're tempted to open that up, what am I saying? And again, I'm not coming against anybody, because I don't have anybody in mind. I want to give you a for instance of what I've seen, and really, Lord's been dealing with me on a case-by-case basis when this pops up, like, who's, like, so you'll see, like, Apostle so-and-so. Well, who gave you that title? You know what I'm saying? We have to be so careful to discern who we're listening to. Pastor Anthony used to have an expression, and I'm just going to use it. You know, we'd see people with, they got a PhD after their name. He used to say, what he used to say, that stands for post-hole digger. But the reality is, when I look at the first century church, right? Peter, of all people, on this rock, I will build my church. Was there anybody that had more issues than Peter? I like to watch The Chosen because I like they're just, because Peter's funny, right? Yeah, you want to fight, you know, squaring off against people, you know, that kind of thing, right? All of them really are interesting. Hey, should we just bring down some fire and kill the Samaritan? Like, dude, really? Yeah, and I can picture Jesus being like, seriously? The reality is, those first century church, you know, the apostles, the disciples that were left after Jesus ascended to the Father, they weren't doctors and lawyers. Yes, they had Luke with them, who was a great writer because he was trained. But the reality was, what were they? They were fishermen, tax collectors. Did they have any Bible schools? Did they have PhDs in this? Were they apostles so-and-so? What were they? Guys that followed Jesus, listened for 3 years. I got to be honest with you. The enemy used to play head games with me. Not anymore, thank God, glory to God, because I finally just shut him up because it wasn't him, it was me. When I started in ministry years ago, I felt unqualified. And I'm giving you guys an example because I don't want to see anybody fall into the pitfall that I fell into, right? And many of you may be called into the ministry. It might be the fivefold ministry. And you haven't stepped out in that call yet because you feel unqualified, right? So when years ago, when Pastor Anthony was here, and I'm going back a number of years ago, and we needed people like here and there to step in on a Wednesday night and minister. Or, you know, I was ministering at Celebrate Recovery as a ministry leader. Even that I felt unqualified to do, of course. But when Pastor Anthony especially asked me to kind of help out, be that extra person when they needed it, and I didn't want a title. I didn't need a title. I didn't have a title. I was just here if you needed me, right? The enemy used to always tell, who are you? Who are you to teach the word? You didn't go to Bible school. You know, you didn't do any of that. You know, so me and my wisdom said, well, I know I was called to ministry. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go do some research, and I'd go out to Rhema. And this is all, we're here because I want everybody to check your hearts as you're watching Christian television or people reading an article, and they're apostle this, prophet this, evangelist, and they could absolutely all be fine. But we need to discern who we're listening to. Because what does it say in the last of the last days? These men and women will rise up with a form of godliness. Because it's going to sound good. Because my ears are itching, and I want you to itch my ears. And I want you to make me feel good about that bad behavior I'm doing. Tell me it's okay. Which never facilitates any real change for God. So we have to carefully discern this, right? And so I thought in my wisdom, that's the key, that was the problem. I'm going to do some research, and I found, I'm going to go get my bachelor's degree in pastoral science from Ohio Christian University. Now, all my college credits, well, majority of them, transferred. Yeah, I was a business major, so didn't really transfer all that to pastoral ministry. Sounds good, and I'm like getting excited, and Pastor Anthony gives me a reference. Good, I get accepted. Start this online course. I was miserable. Truth? Miserable. Like computer science. I want to teach the word. What do I need to know? I can type. I can do Word. I can do Excel spreadsheets. You know, I can do a PDF. I just want to teach. Miserable. Why? Did it in my own strength. It was the enemy telling me I wasn't good enough. I wasn't good enough. It wasn't good enough to sit under men and women of God who fed into my life for years, and God himself, by his Spirit, pouring into me through the word of God to preach because I felt unqualified. That was my own problem. And it was also the enemy reminding me, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are to do this? You don't have any formal degree from anywhere. And then really on the inside, I kept getting, what about the 11 that were left? And then the 12 eventually. What about them? What was their formal education? The word made flesh, which every one of us has available to us. You know, when I hear a man or woman minister of the gospel, I don't go by what's at the end of their name. PhD, doctor, and they're all great. There's nothing wrong with having those. I go by the word that's coming out of their mouth. Because I've heard a first-year student, a young person who's new to the things of God, preach a more powerful message than somebody that's been saved for 40 years with 40 different degrees, because it was born out of their own heart, anointed by the Holy Ghost. We have to be careful. We have to be careful. Now, in this particular case, Paul's talking about, look, in your midst, you have all this available to you, right? Till we come to the unity, we need to get in agreement of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God to a perfect man, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. A perfect man. People always say there was only one of those. Jesus was it. But is it possible for us to go through life and not sin? Can we not sin? absolutely can. Because God would never set a standard for us. Do we have scripture, and I didn't write it down tonight for the sake of time, do we have scripture that says our sole function as we read the Word of God and apply it to our lives is to be more transformed into the image of Jesus Christ himself? So God set a standard that said it's capable for us not to sin. Do we miss it? We do. Is there a possibility of not sinning? Absolutely. But I really believe we can do that. But I also believe we know God looks at and is a discerner of the heart. You know, as we progress and as we make a mistake and as we repent, and true repentance is twofold, right? So many believers miss true repentance. Lord, I'm sorry. But we forget about, well, that also means we got to make that 180-degree turn and turn away from that sin, right? When God sees us doing those steps, man, I know in his heart of hearts, as he sees us develop and he sees us change, with a true heart of repentance. You know, there's false repentance, it seems like. Yeah, I'm going to use that as a crutch to then go do what I want to do again tomorrow. I think have we all been there? Can I be honest and say, I'm sure I have. You know, especially like early on in my walk. Yeah, I did this, but it's really not that big a deal. It's a big deal. God's word says no. No means no. But I really believe that on the inside, as we truly want and desire to change, and if we miss it, man, God's grace is sufficient. He just says, look, I see them. I see that heart. I see them wanting to follow me into the fullness of Christ. Amen. Verse 14, that we should no longer be what? Children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. We're seeing a lot of wind of doctrine in these last of the last days. You know, we looked at it earlier when it talks earlier in chapter 4 about being only one circumcision, one. And that's so important because all this New Age stuff, you're even seeing Christian offshoots that are springing up saying there's multiple ways to God. Carried to and fro with every wind of doctrine. By the trickery of, it doesn't say the enemy. It says by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. When there's deceitful plotting going on, that means it's purposeful. It's being done on purpose to do something of specific harm to you. Deceitful plotting, craftiness, cunning, to every wind of doctrine by trickery of men. Disguised as what so often? By what might sound like the truth. The truth. The whole truth and nothing but the truth will help you God. You can't do that in a court of law anymore. Right? Let me use that as an example. Let's read this again. That we should no longer be children, tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine. Why does Paul use the illustration of wind? Have you ever been out in like a hurricane force wind? Just blows you here and there. And the reality is, there's not really anything you could do about it. When you entertain something that's false, wind of doctrine, now you've got to fight your way back out of it. You're getting blown and moved by everything you hear, usually because it makes you want, again, feel good about something you shouldn't be doing. So let's say, for example, let me go a little bit further, by the trickery of men. We use that as an example, right? We used to go into a court of law and put your left hand on the Bible, raise your right hand, and say, I swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God. I'm 56 years old. Kindergarten, I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America. One nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And if you wanted to kneel and worship God and pray, not a problem. Did God take that out of the school system? Did God take that out of the courtroom? Who did? Welcome to the last of the last days. And then have the audacity, when things go catastrophic in this country, a natural disaster, blame God. But yet, on our money, in God we trust. Blown about by every wind of doctrine. We'll trust him with our treasury, but we won't trust him with the rest of our lives, because it might not be politically correct to do so. By what? Trickery of men. Cunning, craftiness, and deceitful plotting. But what is behind it? Deceits, lies, influence. Coming from where? The God of this world. He's been what? Disarmed. What does that mean? That everybody, and I don't care if you're on, if we're talking, and I'm going to say it like it is, because I just the way I am. I don't care if you're on the left of the aisle, I'm talking about politics, the right of the aisle, you're moderate in the middle, if you're falling for that, you got a problem. You're being deceived by somebody who's been disarmed. What does that mean? Jesus Christ is not a reality in your life. You're allowing the thief to steal, kill, and destroy. The Bible tells us the thief is like, the enemy's like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. When we fall for that, we become a whomso. It's that simple. The influence of somebody that's already been deceived or been disarmed, influencing with no real power to do so unless people allow him to do so. We've taken God out of every, and I'm speaking for us here in this country. And thank glory to God, we're still here. But I don't know if wind of change is going to come with regard to that. Is the church in the United States going to be underground someday? I don't know. I don't care. I care, but we'll still be preaching the gospel. Just like Timothy was when the Romans said, we're going to start killing Christians. Right? I'm going to read 14 again and then go into 15. That we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. We got to stay planted in the Word of God, in the uncompromised truth of the Word. You know, if it feels good or sounds good, that adage, guys, if it sounds too good to be true, sometimes it is. God's Word does sound sometimes too good to be true. But I'll tell you what makes it not too good to be true is that God never promised us that we would just have it without doing anything for it. Meaning we were going to have to fight for it. And if it was too good to be true, God would be like, let go and let me. The big Christianese that you hear in a lot of circles, let go and let God. Sounds so great. Let go and let God. I don't got to do thing one. I'm waiting for my bank account to get bigger. Let go and let God. No, the Word tells us to what? Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold of the promises of God by faith. So all the promises are there. Everything we need, every provision we need is here. But we got to do some fighting. But wait, Pastor, you just said Jesus won. He did. And then he transferred all authority over the enemy who's still around over to you. To do what? Get rid of him. Well, glory to God. What does that mean? Their promises in those general promises in the Word of God and the specific promises that God's given you for your life specifically are yours. And you're going to have to tell the devil to constantly shut up their mind. I've got them. You don't. Get your hands off. I receive them now by faith. And then remind them. Jesus made a fool out of you. You've been disarmed. Me and Jody were just talking about this on the way over. Do we need to? You need something in your life, whatever it is. Healing, finances, relationship restoration. All those things, God says, they're yours. If you need them, do we have to pray over and over and over till we have them? Or do we pray and then start thanking him? Do we need to heap up prayers over and over again? Or do we need to pray? Believe we receive. I wasn't going to go here, but it was in here for a reason. All right, Lord, this is yours, not mine. Hold on. I don't know why I just pulled this out before. Mark 11, 22 and 23. So Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. Be assuredly, I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things that he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. As long as he continues to pray over and over again for the same thing, he'll get them. We all miss it here, right? Therefore, I say to you, whenever things you ask, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. I want you guys to notice something. Therefore, I say, one, to you, whatever things you ask, when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. Actually, Bonnie, go up to verse 22. I'm sorry. We're going to do that over. So Jesus answered and said to them, have faith in God. That is Jesus saying, here's your answer. Right? So Jesus, verse 23, for assuredly I say to you, whoever says to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes those things that he says will be done, he will have whatever he says. Verse 24, therefore I say to you, whatever thing you ask when you pray, believe you will receive them, and you will have them. Is the saying stuff kind of important? Say appears there more than believe does. What do? Pray it, believe it once, receive it, and now start speaking to it. Say it. Say it. Have to keep up that good confession of faith. And we're going to close with this. We're going to still in verse 14. All right, so that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men in the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting. But here's the answer. And this can be hard. This can be hard with brothers and sisters in Christ. This could be hard with family members. This could be hard with, look, as my walk with the Lord progressed, I literally had to distance myself, and I'm talking for my wife as well, from people I dearly loved to be around. But that now become toxic in a way, for lack of a better term, to your walk with the Lord. And quite honestly, many of them didn't like the way we were changing. Well, we remember you when. Yeah, but I'm not that when anymore. I've seen something. Even if I've told them, like a lot of the people that I grew up with and remember me when, and my when was an ugly when, will be like, and I'll tell them, look, I was called in the ministry when I was 10 years old, way before the when you ever knew happened. I was a 10-year-old kid. What did I know back then, right? And they'd be like, oh, no, not you. Yeah, me. I just ran away from it. So here I is now, and the reality has become we don't stop loving these people. But you've got to be careful because you become who you behold. So the more time you spend with people that are not feeding into you the things of God, and even the people like you, and you're not having an ability to feed into those who maybe aren't as far advanced as you. That's the way this walk was designed to be. You know, I'm not the smartest person in my group. I don't want to be. I want to be around people that are smarter than me. You know, glory to God, I've had men and women in my life who, you know, Pastor Eddie, Pastor Anthony, Miss Carol, right? People that fed into my life, Brother Keith Moore, you know, Pastor Hagen, you know, and still have to have that relationship. You know, I don't know all I know. You know, Pastor Eddie's 5 years younger than me. He's been doing this in ministry since he went to Bible school at 17. I could pick up the phone and phone a friend and like, dude, what do you think of this? You know, he's been in the ministry world a lot longer than I have. Age means nothing. He's my brother in the Lord, but he's also a spiritual mentor to me. I don't care the fact that he's 5 years older than me or younger than me. What does that got to do with anything? You know, means nothing. Right? So here's the answer. But speaking the truth in love may grow up in all things into him who is the head, Christ, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth for the body for the edifying of itself in love. What does that mean? Well, we just looked at, here's all, this started off by talking about, here is all the fivefold ministry gifts. You know how you discern if somebody that's in the fivefold ministry is doing what they should be doing? Their ministry is bearing fruit. For who? The kingdom, not for themselves. Themselves is an offshoot of serving God. I know plenty of ministers that are super abundantly blessed. They didn't set out for the financial side of it. They set out to follow God wholeheartedly and be a blessing for the body of the church as a whole. And the offshoot was it, they couldn't turn off the financial side of it, right? I've seen men and women of God sow every last cent they've had in their church bank accounts to support another ministry and get blessed. We'll know them by their what? Their fruits. The title at the end of their name means really nothing. Means really nothing. How many times have I turned on a show on Christian television? Remember, it's television. They pay to be there, right? And heard messages that do not line up with the Word of God. And it makes me want to throw my shoe at the television. It does. The reality is, you will know them by their fruit. Are they bearing fruit? Are we bearing fruit? You know, are we bearing fruit? Are we being tossed to and fro by every little doctrine that comes along that sounds good? Because if you entertain another doctrine, here's what I encourage you to do, and I really am going to close with this. I got to land this plane tonight. The landing gear's down, I promise. We're approaching. Put your tray tables up, seat backs up. We're good. The reality is, when we get tempted to entertain something else, we need to check our hearts and say, am I entertaining this because I want to feel good about something I'm doing that I shouldn't? Trust me, that hurts. I get it. But do you know what I'm saying? Like, wow, that he just said that thing I'm doing isn't so bad. He's got a PhD at the end of his name. Okay. You understand what I'm saying? We got to check on the inside. Or am I using that as an excuse to offset that check that I just got from the Spirit of God on the inside of me to tell me to stop? You know, Patty from Uttermost said this when she was here. She said, so many of us want God to tell us to go do this, go do that, go do this for me. And we wonder why we don't get it. And we don't get it because we never obey the stops. Stop doing this. Stop doing that. Only you know what your stop is. Amen? Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you for the truth of your word, Father. Oh, Lord, we thank you that you are so, so good to us. Thank you for pouring into us this evening. Bring glory to yourself, Lord. You are so, so good. We thank you for it all in Jesus' name. And before we go, guys, don't forget, we have the ladies' meeting tomorrow night at 6 p.m., so come on out, ladies of Abundant Grace Church. This Saturday, if you haven't signed up, men, we're having a little men's fellowship this Saturday, 12 to 4. Come on out. We're going to have some food, some fellowship, some cornhole, some pickleball, whatever you guys want to do. We will be here. And then Sunday, the 29th at 5 p.m., we are doing praise and worship night. So our quarterly praise and worship night is the 29th. So come on out for praise and worship and then fellowship and food afterward. Because, like, what would it be without food? You know? We do like to eat. Glory to God. We love you guys. We will see you either Faith and Healing School Thursday or Friday or this Sunday. Amen.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure can.
Yeah.